Hi, I'm Troy from Studio 33 Guitar. Thanks for watching. Today we're going to have a look at Shut Up and Dance by Walk the Moon. This is a great song. It's a lot of fun to play. Now, as you listen to it, you may notice there's a lot of different parts and it may seem complicated. And there are a number of things to think about. However, I'll break it down and show you a few different ways you can play it. So regardless of your skill level, you'll be able to play along with this song. You can see from the intro, I played it both with a capo and without a capo. And I'll show you how to do both of those ways. Let's start with the simplest way to play it, which would be using a capo. And we're going to put our capo on the 6th fret. Now, this song is originally recorded in the key of D flat or C sharp. And that's an awkward key to play in on guitar, which is why we're going to use the capo. The original recording, they actually tuned their guitars down a half step. So you could do that as well, and I'll show you how to do that a little bit later in the video. And we're going to use basic beginner type chords, G, C, E minor, and D. Popular chords that are used in a lot of songs. The capo enables us to play those in a different key. So even though we're still using the same chord shapes, the shape of a G chord, technically with the capo, it'll actually be a D flat chord. But to keep it simple, I'm going to call the chords by the shape name. So when I say G chord, it's the G chord shape, but technically we are playing a D flat chord. If you've watched some of my other videos, you know that I use these chords a lot, G, C, E minor, and D, and then move the capo around in order to make it in the right key for the song. I also play these chords maybe a little bit differently than you might be used to. And I have another video on my other channel, Studio 33 Guitar, that's called The Four Most Important Chords to Know. If you have a look at that, it explains these chords in more detail. I'll go through them real quickly here. For our G chord, it's going to look like a regular G chord shape. What might be different for you is this ring finger. So we have two fingers on these top two strings. Sometimes a G chord is played with just that bottom note using your ring finger or with the pinky finger. Now we're going to play it with these two fingers on there. So that'll be our G chord. The next chord is going to be what's called a C add 9 chord. And all we're going to do for that is just drop these two fingers down, keep that same shape, and that's our C chord. For E minor, we're going to use an E minor 7, and that means it's going to be like a regular E minor chord, but we're keeping those two fingers down here. So you have an E minor, E minor 7, and then a D chord. And there, the ring finger gets to stay in that same spot, regular D chord, like that. As a beginner way to play this song, you can play those four chords throughout the entire song. The verse, the pre-chorus, the chorus. There'll just be some differences in how we play the rhythm or the strumming pattern. When you listen to the original song, the verses are really stripped back and it's really just the bass that's playing some notes. And those notes are a little different than the chords that we're playing, but if you know a little bit about music theory, the notes that the bass player is playing is implying these chords. So these chords will fit over top of what the bass player is playing. So as you play along with the recording, you'll notice that what you're playing might sound a little bit different than what the recording is sounding like. But that's okay, these chords will fit over top. And if you're playing this song on your own, you'll want to be able to fill in that extra space. So using these chords works well. The timing of when these chords change is important, so let's have a look at that. If you're familiar with how to count music, normally we count in groups of four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Every time we count to four, we're counting one bar or one measure of music. For this song, the G chord takes half a bar, and then it goes to the C chord for half a bar. So that would be one, two, three, four. And then the same with the E minor and D. One, two, three, four. So each gets half a bar. There's one important part here is that that second chord each time comes just a little bit ahead of beat three. So instead of counting one, two, three, four, we'll count eighth notes. And when we count eighth notes, we count one and two and three and four and. That second chord ends up coming in on the and after two. So it ends up making that chord come a little bit early. It kind of gives it a little bit more of a pushing feel. So to demonstrate that would be like this. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. For the strum pattern, there's a lot of different options that you can use for this song. What I would recommend is for the verses, you want to kind of keep the feel and the sound a little bit lower and a little bit more laid back, and then you want to pick it up and create more intensity on the chorus. So for the verse, I would play it fairly straight and probably play every eighth note. So that's the one and two and. And I would probably use all downstrokes. And I would even add in palm muting. Now, if you're not familiar with what palm muting is, I have another video on the other channel that talks a little bit more about how to do palm muting. But the basic idea is use this part of your hand to rest lightly on the bridge and just touch on the strings, gives it more of a muted sound. So that would sound like this. One and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. For the pre-chorus section of the song, we're gonna use these same chords, but now we're gonna change the rhythm. We're gonna put some dead space in between the chords. That's gonna sound like this. For that part of the song, you can see the chords stay the same, but we just changed the strumming pattern. Now we're going to be playing two downstrokes for each chord and putting in dead space in between. So that's going to be like this. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. To make those chords stop ringing after you play them, you can use the palm of your hand again to touch down across the strings to stop them from ringing. So that would be like this. Some of my other videos, I refer to that as the chop. It's the same technique. Now, at the same time, you can also gently lift your fingers off the fretboard. You don't want to take your fingers completely off the strings, off the chord. You just don't want to be squeezing like you are when you're playing the chord. So squeeze it when you're playing it. As you do the palm muting, you just gently relax the hand. So again, that would be like this. For that pre-chorus section, we play that G, C, E minor, D, and the second time we play it again, G, C, and then straight to that D chord. So we don't play that E minor the second time around. So altogether, that would sound like this. One variation you can do on that section to make it sound a little bit more like the original is instead of playing that G chord at the beginning, you could play a G over B. Now, if you're not sure what that is, it's quite simple. You take your regular G chord and just remove that middle finger and have your index finger as the lowest note of the chord. And that gives you a G over B. In a regular G chord, that index finger would be a B note. Now that we're playing in D flat, it's a little different, but again, that's a G over B shape. Now what you want to do is use that index finger just to gently nudge up against that low E string to keep it from ringing, because we don't want that as part of the chord anymore. So if you gently push up against that string, it'll mute it out. You don't have to worry about missing it as you strum. So then with that chord, that sequence would sound like this. And that brings us to the chorus section of the song. And that's played again using those same chords, but now we're gonna change the strumming pattern again. Now there are a number of different options that you can use for the strumming pattern, and it will vary depending on how you're playing the song. If you're playing it by yourself, maybe you're just at home and you're wanting to play a little bit more laid back, a little bit quieter, then you can do a simpler strumming pattern. If you're playing with a band and you're trying to make it sound a little bit more like the original, and you're trying to get your part to blend in with what everybody else is doing, then you may want to be playing a little bit more aggressively, maybe a faster, more complicated strumming pattern. Let's take a look at a couple of different examples of what you could do. One simple way to play it would be to be playing full eighth notes, still doing downstrokes, but not doing palm muting. So then you would have this. One and two and three and four and one and two Another way that you could play it that's a little bit more rhythmically interesting is with some upstrokes, and that would be like this. So let's break that strumming pattern down a little bit. So you have a down up on that first chord. Down up, down up. And then you're gonna go right to that next C chord and you're gonna do a down stroke for that. So you've got this. Down up, down. Down up, down. After you play that down stroke on the C chord, you're gonna play a sequence like this. Down up, down up, down, down up. If you wanna make that strum a little bit more energetic, then you can add in a couple of more strums at the end of that one that I just showed you. So this would be using 16th notes, and that would sound like this. For that strumming pattern, it's very quick, and you're keeping your wrist and your pick going up and down for that 16th note count the entire time. But you're not strumming every time your hand goes up or down. So the count for counting 16th notes, it's a little bit funny, but it's 1E and 2E and 3E and 4E and So when you're strumming, you wanna keep that hand going in that same speed, 1E and 2E and 3E and 4E and But you don't wanna strum the strings every time you're going up and down. So you end up with this pattern. For that first chord, now we're playing down, down, up, up. And then we're coming to the next chord, that C chord on the down again. So we have this, down, down, up, up, down. Down, down, up, up, down. And now we're playing straight 16th notes, up, down, up, up, down, up, up, down, up. So that would be like this, down, down, up. Then you do that same sequence for the next set of chords. Down, down, up, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. That one will take a little bit more work. You'll need to just slow that down. Get comfortable with that strum before you try and do it fast. And that's how to play all the different parts of that song using the capo. So let's have a look at it now using more of a power chord type shapes without using a capo. You're probably familiar with how to play a power chord, but let's go through that quickly in case you don't. A power chord is simply a two-note chord that uses a root note and a fifth note. Now don't get too worried about the theory behind that because the shape of the chord stays the same. So every power chord is played the same way. So our root note for this first chord is going to be a D flat. So D flat is going to be located on the A string on the fourth fret. So that's our D flat note. To play a fifth above that, we're going to go down one string and then up the neck two frets. So we're going to put our pinky finger on that note. Now you could use your ring finger too if that's more comfortable. I usually use my pinky finger. So then you end up with these two notes. And those are the only two notes you're going to use for that chord. And that's called a power chord. Now these other strings, you're going to want to just lay your pinky finger just over those strings to keep them from ringing. So then if you play them, you'll get that clicking sound. But as you play the chord, you won't hear that. Now you can also use your index finger to again just block and touch up lightly on that low E string to keep it from ringing. So you also get that clicking sound for that. And then that way you're able to play a little bit more aggressively. You don't have to be real careful with where you're playing with the pick. So you can play three or four strings here and not worry about ones ringing that you don't want. So by muting out those strings, you can get this sound. And you can see I'm playing fairly aggressively here. I'm not worried too much about what strings that I'm hitting because I'm controlling that with this hand. So the four basic chords that we need for this are this D flat. And then we need a G flat, and that's going to be up a string and then move your hand down. So your first index finger is going to be on the second fret of the E string. And then you want to keep that same shape that you had before. So down a string and over two. And that's where you're going to put your pinky finger. And that gives you that G flat. And now again, try and lay that pinky finger across those other strings so they don't come out. So you have your D flat, move up to the G flat. And now you're going to go all the way up to a B flat. And that's going to come all the way up here to the sixth fret. So in between these two dots. And again, same shape. Keep that pinky finger sort of locked in that position. So you're down a string and over two. That's your B flat. And then you're gonna bring that down two frets to A flat. Okay, so together you have this. The chords that we're using here are the same chords that we were using up here when we were playing with the capo, but now we're just using these power chord shapes. The important part is that the chords need to change the same timing as the chords we were using previously. So we're going to be changing on the and after two. So we're counting one and two and three and four and we're changing on the and after two. So that would be one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. As far as the strum pattern for the verse, I would play it probably the way that I just did that demonstration, where I'm playing eighth notes and playing all down strums, and I'd probably add in some palm muting as well. So that would be one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. Next, that leads us to the pre-chorus. The pre-chorus, we're going to be using the same chords, but slightly different shapes. Gives it a slightly different sound. So the pre-chorus goes like this. So that part starts out with a D flat chord again, but this time it's going to be with an F note in the bass. So to do that, you're going to take your D flat chord, and now instead of using your index finger on that D flat note, you're going to put your pinky finger on that note. And that frees up this index finger to get this F note, which is the first fret on the E string. So that gives a little bit of a stretch, might be a little bit awkward at first, but just keep working on that. So then you have this chord, which is actually a D flat with an F in the bass. And then we're gonna go to a G chord, which is the same one we did earlier. You're just gonna move your index finger up one fret, and that'll give you that G flat chord again. So that would be. So your pinky finger stays in that same spot for both of those chords. Then you're gonna go back to the original D flat chord. And now the index finger is gonna do basically the opposite of what we just did. So we're gonna move that index finger down the neck one fret. So we have this. From there, it goes to the A flat chord. So far you have this. And then it repeats those first two. But now instead of going to the D flat, you're gonna go up to the A flat. And that leads to the chorus. So that section again would be like this. And now we're into the chorus section, which is played the same way as the verse. We're playing the D flat, G flat, B flat, and A flat with the same timing. And the strum can be the same way. With these power chords, that's really what works best, is just that straight eighth note feel, one and two and three and four and all downstrokes. Let me just wrap this up by mentioning one more way that you could play this song. If you tune your guitar down to flat tuning, so you'd have the E flat, A flat, D flat, and so on, just tune all the strings down one semitone, you could play this song using regular open chords as well. If you were to do that, then you would play a D chord, a G chord, B flat minor, and A. So those would be your four chords that you would use for verse, chorus, pre-chorus, all the different sections, you would just use those chords. If you didn't want to tune down, you could also play it that way if you're wanting to just play the song on your own by yourself and not play along with the recording. But if you want to play with the recording, you will have to tune the guitar down. That's the entire song. I hope that you found this useful. If you did, please let us know by hitting the like button, leave a comment down below, subscribe to this channel. You can also check out our other channel, Studio 33 Guitar, which focuses more on music theory and technique. We also have a website, studio33guitar.com, where you can find more free lessons. And we're also on all the social media sites, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram. You can find us there as well under Studio 33 Guitar. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.